forget about all the flowery spiritual stuff. This is more like cleaning up like a toxic dump site, really. And it involves use of spiritual will. All right, this is where the work really gets done. Let those who want to talk about enlightenment, talk about non-duality, talk about that, let them talk, that's fine. But what we do here is we use our spiritual will to actually get it done. And this is a tough work, actually. Not everybody likes this, but some do. There's no need for any dialogue here. The dialogue's not going to get it done. Don't worry about, say, well, what questions do I have to ask? What do I need to say? What kind of dialogue do I need to have? Don't need to have any of that. Just need to practice. Just need to practice. This is what the ego, that derelict bum that has been running our lives like a squatter, in our psyche, in our being, that has just made our lives miserable, that tells us, no, we can't practice, you can't do that. Well, guess what? We can, and we are. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. And now I joyfully see that I am not a body, that I am free, that I am spirit, exactly as God created me. And now I joyfully see that I am not a body, that I am free, that I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. Now, this is the one thing that this derelict squatter who's filled your life with toxicity, who's filled your being with toxicity, that's the one thing they don't want you to do. They don't want you to clean up your spiritual environment, because when it's clean, they can't stand it. And they're going to leave. They're going to leave. You don't have to kick that bum out. They're going to leave on their own accord. When you clean up the stench, the rot, the stench, the horrible atmosphere there, and it's clean. And the way we do it is by practicing, by putting it in nice, neat little bags, not trying to do it all once. That's too much. Trying to do it all at once is too much. Okay. But by bit by bit, we package it up in plastic bags and so we can dispose of the toxic waste like that. And once the environment gets clean, it's all cleaned up, that squatter will say, I'm leaving, I'm out of here, because they can't stand it. They can't stand it. So don't engage in any dialogue with this squatter at all. Just keep cleaning, keep cleaning, keep cleaning. Clean your inner spiritual environment by saying, oh, now I see that I am not a body, that I am free, that I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. Okay, so these are the parameters. We sit without slouching and facing forward like a spiritual marine, not retreating, not slouching, not retreating. Sit quietly, sit calmly, hands to hands, we're not scratching, and you know, hands to hands as much as possible, hands to hands, severely modest attitude, which is a working attitude. We're like a blue collar working attitude here. Okay, this is where it's at. Let the dilettantes pretend to be sophisticated, and with all their sophisticated spiritual stuff, we're blue collar, hard working, get it done, practicing. This is what actually works. So if you really are tired of this horrible squatter bullying you and ruining your life, then you're going to use your spiritual will. Okay, we'll talk about this now. The intellect's out of the picture. It's overwhelmed by the situation. The situation is so intense. The intellect, we just realize it's way over its head, and so just put it on the sidelines. That's okay. It doesn't really mind. You just have to use your will to recognize this. Don't try to use the intellect primarily at all. Spiritual will got us into this problem. Spiritual will gets us out of this problem. Okay, we willed or used our spiritual will to try and deceive God through faith, having faith that we could deceive God. So now we use faith in a different way. We use faith to practice asserting that we cannot deceive God, and that's okay. No deception has ever happened, actually. So spiritual will, the way we practice is to use faith. We say, and now I see, and now I joyfully see that I am not a body, that I am free, that I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. This is the right use of faith. We cannot simply get rid of faith like this. It's too difficult for us. There's too much continuity fear to do this. So we're stuck with faith for the time being, temporarily. We're stuck with it. So we either use it one way or the other. Either we use faith to keep believing that that God has been deceived or will be deceived by definition, which is existence. This world you see, you think you see, we think we see. We have faith that there's a world here. We have faith we're bodies. We have faith there's a universe. We have faith that there's time. We have faith that there's process. We have faith that there's time, space, process, and form. This is all faith. This is our faith. That is how strong this technique we're using, our will to have faith that all this is so. It's not so at all, actually. It's 100% based on faith. We are, think with it, we're seeing all this based on faith. We have faith that it's there. We have faith there's a world. Okay, and a spiritual world, meaning definition, meaning separation, meaning some degrees and levels of inclusiveness, degree, everything's stratified and different. This is what we call a world, spiritual world. It's totally based on faith. There isn't any such stratification. Sensory perception makes it seem like there is. It generates false evidence because anything closer to us seems more inclusive, more included in experiencing than stuff that's farther away. Okay, this is the inherent distortion of sensory perception. But that is just reinforcing what our spiritual will and faith is already believing in, that there is this change in reality and that God has to accept this and therefore become less than what God actually is, and therefore we can say we change God and we're greater than God. So this is all designed to deceive God and change God. And yet we know, spiritually we know, it hasn't worked and will never work. So what do we do with this faith that we have? We have all this belief, this faith, this false perception, this familiarity, all of this. So this is overwhelming to the intellect. The scope of all this is overwhelming to the intellect. So forget about the intellect. Don't worry about the intellect. It's overwhelmed, and that's fine. But we have spiritual will. The same will that got us into this predicament gets us out of this predicament. The same faith that has sustained this predicament now dissolves the predicament for us, evaporates it for us. The same, we're using faith to now evaporate what faith has been believing in. Okay, we know a faith evaporates faith, so to speak. Okay, and then eventually we know, but that's down the road. We're not worried about that. But we are acting as if we know. This is called right use of faith. Right use of faith. So we say this very simple practice, but it's this practice is like putting hazardous waste in a nice sealed plastic bag where it's now can be disposed of safely, so to speak, like that. Say, and now I see, and now I see, and now I see that I am not a body. I am free. I am spirit exactly as God created me. We're saying we're using faith now in the right way, and we're using spiritual will in the right way. We're willing this. We're using. There's nothing in our intellect or feeling that's telling us to do this, really, right? This derelict is saying, I'm not budging, and the stench is terrible. The overall feeling. It's like, you know, it's like a stench, like contamination. We feel like we're contaminated. And so we're saying, oh, this is horrible. Well, yeah. Yeah, it is. But how do we clean it up? It's got to be cleaned up. So this is where we use our will to practice. The will to practice is all important. Don't think that you have to have the intellect on board. You don't. In fact, the intellect's not on board. The intellect is like almost comatose. It's over in a corner, just like slouching in a corner like this. It's overwhelmed. That's okay. We forgive. We thank and forgive all our flimsy defenses, all our flimsy pretenses. And see, when spiritual will is in control, it doesn't need the intellect at that point because it's practicing. Okay, when you're not practicing, you need the intellect to put up a good front. Like, so I'm going to get you at some point. I'm not going to give up. That's fine. But when you're practicing, you don't need it anymore. So it's not gone. It's just on the sidelines. And it can come into the picture a little bit, but it's not in charge. It's not driving. It's not driving. And so we will have this feeling I had this dream last night that pictured this whole thing. I experienced it, and boy, all this, it's like a house full of empty booze bottles, and all were poured into this container. So we're emptying it out. The stench was so terrible. We were almost passing out. You know, these workers who are working to clean this up. I said, "Wow, it's horrible." But then I came on the scene and said, no, it's not that bad. We can do it." And I came up with this idea of packaging in plastic bags. And I saw that this idea had already been, we've been working on this, and somehow it had already been done. We're almost finished. And then this squatter, this alcoholic bum squatter who'd been living here for so long and drinking all this booze, just boozing it up, he finally got up and said, I'm going down to Mexico. I'm going south. I'm leaving. And what you're going to do is, I'm going to go watch the people walk on hot coals down there. I said, okay, whatever. And he's leaving. He said, I can't take it. I don't like it here anymore. See, we'd clean it up and say, I don't like it here anymore, I'm leaving. Fine, we just keep cleaning up, that's all. So as I've said, once we keep practicing, automatically this makes it intolerable for those things which have been making it intolerable for us, right? So, since we don't need to explain too much, the intellect's not in charge. We are in charge. The spiritual will. We know. Spiritual will already knows, but there's this continuity fear. So we have to practice and say, I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. And now I see. I joyfully see that I'm not a body. That I am free. That I'm still spirit, exactly as God created me. And now I'm delighted to see that I'm not a body, that I'm free, that I'm still spirit, exactly as God created me. And now I'm delighted to see that I am not a body, that I am free, that I'm still spirit, exactly as God created me. And now I'm very delighted to see that I am not a body, that I am free, that I'm still spirit, exactly as God created me. So what are we doing? We're using our faith and will here. We're using the will to practice, and we're using faith to feel as if we are seeing it. Say, yeah, I kind of do see it. Say, yeah, I'm seeing it. We're having faith that we're seeing it. We're having faith in this. This is right use of faith. If we don't use faith this way, we'll use faith to believe we're not seeing it, one way or the other. So there's no fence here. With faith, there's no fence. You know, it's active. It's this active believing. It's active belief. Faith is this active belief. So we have to use this active belief to say, yes, and now I'm delighted. I'm so delighted that I'm now seeing that I'm not a body, that I am free, that I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. Nothing has changed. My spirit hasn't changed at all from how God created me. So now I'm delighted to actually be seeing that I'm not a body, that I'm free, that I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. And now I'm already delighted. Now I'm already so delighted to see that I'm already not a body, that I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. And now I'm so delighted to see that I'm not a body. I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. So we're believing, we're having faith that we're actually seeing this, not thinking it, but seeing it. We're actually seeing this. It's apparent to us, as if very clearly we're seeing it, as clearly as you could possibly imagine seeing anything. It is being seen, not thought out as a concept, but being seen. So I'm delighted to see that I'm not a body, that I'm free, that I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. I'm delighted to see that I'm not a body, that I'm free, that I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. And now I'm so delighted to see that I'm not a body, that I am free, that I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. Now, when I saw in this dream this all this toxic waste, so to speak, this, I said, how in the world? I can't possibly carry that out all at once. That's going to break my truck. I mean, it's too much. It's just overwhelming. And then this idea popped into my head, hey, how about packaging it up in these bags, bit by bit? I said, yeah, that'll work. Because then I can put these, and I just like, this'll work. And then I saw the workers are already doing this, and someone was there saying, yeah, we're with the program, and we know this works. I said, yeah, this is definitely going to work. And then this bum, this alcoholic bum, said, I'm leaving, I'm out of here, forget it, I'm going. I mean, it works. Remember, the ego's logic is to say, it's impossible that it ever leave us, but if you do this one practice, it will leave us. So it's impossible to do this practice. But this is not reason, this is just wishful thinking. Saying, the ego saying it will never leave us is just wishful thinking. That's all. We're wishfully thinking, oh, I'm too afraid to, that I don't want the ego to leave. I want to keep believing that God is deceived. God is not deceived. Okay, we never deceive God at all. And so we thank our flimsy, pretentious defenses. All our flimsy, pretentious defenses. We thank them and forgive them and release them all. Okay? And now we package them up and dispose of them. Okay, we package them up by practicing. We package it up by practicing. And now I'm delighted to see, I'm truly delighted to see that I am not a body, that I am free, that I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. And now I'm truly delighted to see that I'm not a body, that I'm free, that I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. And now I am truly delighted to see that I'm not a body, that I'm free, that I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. And now I'm truly delighted to see that I'm not a body, that I'm free, that I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. And now I am truly delighted to see that I am not a body, that I'm free, that I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. And now I'm so delighted to see that I'm not a body, that I am free, that I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. And now I am truly delighted to see that I'm not a body, that I am free, that I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. And now I am so delighted to see that I am not a body, that I am free, that I am still spirit exactly as God created me. And now I am so delighted to see that I am not a body, that I am free, that I am still spirit exactly as God created me. Now, you know, in our practice, we have three parts, right? The practice, the wow, and the flipping of the script. Okay, this is our practice. So we have a practice here, which is super important. Super important. We have a practice. We don't have to throw faith away altogether like that. This, because our continuity fear, very likely in almost all cases, no one's going to do that now. So we have a practice. And so we can practice. We're not afraid of the continuity fear anymore. It doesn't bully us anymore. We have a practice. We have the practice. The practice is three parts. We have the practice. We have the wow, full stop in the wow. And we have the flipping the script. Okay? So as we practice this, we get this wow feeling because we say, this is working. Wow. And we're temporarily almost overwhelmed by gratitude and just this feeling that this is, we're going to succeed here. This is working. This is just, you know, fantastic. And at some point, it just, we just overwhelms us. You know, this is so great. And so we have to recognize this. And not overdo it. Not overdo it, but take these little breaks. Okay. Not overdo it. That leads to backlash and panic and retreat. So our practice is we practice, we take a little break like this. We say, wow, this actually does work. Now, we say, well, does that mean I'm going to be a teacher, a guru, is that a teacher, a guy? Well, a better way to look at it is to say, and so now this is the flipping the script phase. You see, we calm down from the wow phase enough, so then we flip the script so we don't feel so much wow. We don't feel so much wow. And then we can practice again. Got it? It's a positive cycle that we have here of success. We flip the script. And we say, well, you know, I don't have to define it as a teacher or a guru or a saint or a sage or whatever, bodhisattva. I can say, I'm just so delighted to see. I'm just delighted. I'm so delighted to see that I'm not a body, that I'm free, that I am still spirit exactly as God created me. I'm just so delighted to see that I'm not a body, that I'm free, that I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. So people say, well, what's going on with you? I say, well, I'm just so delighted to finally see that I'm not a body, that I'm free, that I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. So you can just be this delight. You know, I'm so delighted. That's all. I'm so delighted to see this. And so we just practice this. People will say all sorts of things about you, this and this and this and this, and you can say, I'm not saying anything about I'm not labeling myself really in any way. I'm just so delighted to see, and I invite others to share this delight in seeing that I'm not a body, that I'm free, that I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. And you see how we flip the script here. This is what we're about. We have this three-phase practice. The assertion, full stop in the wow, flip the script, and then go back to the assertion. I'm so delighted to see that I am not a body, that I am free, that I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. I am so delighted to see that I am not a body, that I am free, that I am still spirit exactly as God created me. And people will say, well, how do we define you? How do we define you? Say, you know, I don't know how to define me. I'm just so delighted to see that I'm not a body, that I'm free of definition, actually, and that I am still spirit exactly as God created me. And so you can, you know, if you feel you have to define me, you can define whatever way you want to. It doesn't matter to me. I'm so delighted to see that I am not a body, that I am free, that I am still spirit exactly as God created me. All praise to practice which has been suggested to me by the great ones who have are already in this great delight of seeing this. I don't want to label them as gurus, teachers, what? No, the ones who are already fully in delight of seeing that they are not a body, that they are free, that they are still spirit, exactly as God created them to be. These are the ones that have suggested this to me. And through me, this is being suggested to others now. And they've also suggested it. I don't know who else they've suggested it to, but who knows? But they have suggested it to me, that practice like this, okay? And look, approach it like this way, this approach. And so this is very much a flipping the script approach, right? I'm like on the new ground, new territory, so to speak. We're not claiming anything for ourselves except to say that all I can say about myself is that I'm so delighted to see that I'm not a body, that I'm free, that I'm still spirit, exactly as God created me. You know, I'm just simply so delighted and sharing this delight. That's all. I'm not saying I'm a non-dual teacher. I'm not saying I'm an Advaitin. I'm not saying I'm a radical Dzogchen teacher. I'm not saying I'm a guru. I'm not saying I'm a saint. I'm not saying I'm a sage. I'm not saying I'm a savior. I'm not saying I'm a teacher of God. I'm not saying any of that at all. All I'm saying is I'm so delighted to see that I'm not a body, that I'm free, that I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. That's all I'm saying about me. That's all I'm experiencing. This is what I'm so delighted to see this. That's all. And then just, you know, I'm just, this delight is overflowing. And there may be some of you, I'm sure there are, or else you wouldn't be watching, that this is seeping into you and saying, wow. And it's seeping into me too, okay? We're walking together in the wow here, okay? We're walking together in the wow. I haven't eaten breakfast or drinking anything this morning. I just got up and said, I have to tape. This is important. We're walking together in the wow, and I'm seeing the effectiveness, the genius behind this. You know, this is, it's not coming from me, so to speak. This is coming from those who've already done this, you know, and I've just been trying to asking them for help, and they've been helping, but what they say is so revolutionary, you know. It's just wow, good grief, this isn't the way that the world is going about it, is it? And they say, no, it's not, but this is more effective. They say, try this effectiveness. Let's not say it's more or less, because that gets us into arguments, but they're saying this can be very effective, extremely effective. It can be extremely effective. We will not compare it with other effectiveness, but let's put it this way, that there are those in the world, there are those for whom it will be very effective, very effective. All right, and for those who have other ways and want to say other things, fine, that doesn't bother us, because we are overflowing with delight to see that I am not a body, that I am free, that I am still spirit exactly as God created me. So again, what is our practice? We do have a practice. It is three-phase practice. Assertion. The assertion that I am not a body, that I am free, that I am still spirit exactly as God created me. Okay, so we want in this practice to have at least one constant, all right? This is the constant that we're introducing. Because once we get into the wow, we are overflowing, right? Our cup is overflowing. And it's just like, wow, my cup cannot contain this. We have a container. I don't have one here, but I do have this bottle. I mean, imagine if we're pouring water into this bottle, and it just overflows. The bottle's too small to contain it. And so our expectations, the world, everything that we've believed in is too constricted to contain this. It overflows. And so we're just saying, wow, it's just overflowing on the ground, splashing on the ground. Just like, you say, wow, just let it overflow. It's okay, but it's wow. So this is not a constant. This sort of overwhelms us. And then flipping the script is we're going into very inspirational, abstract considerations like, hey, let's look at it this way or that way. That's not a constant either, is it? It's very volatile as we're working toward inspiration to flip the script that we've been stuck in. So we do need to have one constant in this practice. Otherwise, it'll overwhelm us and we'll get off. We need to say, oh, I know I can return. I know what I'm returning to. I know what my home base is returning to. We're out there overflowing and exploring in abstraction. And then we say, yeah, but I know where home is. I am so delighted to see that I am not a body, that I am free, that I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. So we do have a practice. Hallelujah. We do have a practice. We are not adrift. We are not overwhelmed. We have a practice. This is so important going forward now with this world, quote unquote, this world, this belief system, this faith-based belief system in time, space, process, and form. And that's all it is. It's 100% a faith-based belief system based on spiritual will, having the desire to try and be greater than God, and realizing it can't make God, we can't actually make ourselves greater than God, but we believe, we have a faith-based belief system that we can make ourselves, we can make God lesser. And by making ourselves subject to what we believe is lesser time, space, process, and form, we believe that since we're one with God, that pulls God down also. It pulls God down, and then we say we've succeeded. All right. The kicker is that this is only a faith-based belief system. We're just imagining time, space, process, and form. It doesn't actually exist. We're having faith. We have faith that it exists. The only existence that all this has is simply mere faith. That's it. So obviously we're not ready to jettison faith altogether, are we? That vanish. We'd realize that we would wake up instantly and it would vanish without a trace, as if it never was. We're not ready. That's the overly direct approach that we're advised not to struggle with that. That is not the way to succeed. The doing it all at once approach. We're saying we're packaging up bit by bit through our practice. But we're using faith to say, yeah, this has already succeeded. I know it's already succeeded. So I am delighted to see. I'm so delighted to see that I'm not a body. That I'm free. That I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. And now I am so delighted to see that I'm not a body. That I'm free. That I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. I am so delighted to see that I am not a body. That I'm free. That I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. I am so delighted to see that I'm not a body, that I'm free, that I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. So we're using our faith. We have a faith-based belief system now that we are seeing this. We are literally experiencing this. We're seeing it, totally seeing it without any obscuration whatsoever, absolutely clearly seeing this, and we're so delighted to see this. Okay, we're using faith-based, we have a faith-based belief system now. We flip the script entirely, and we're believing we are seeing this, and we're feeling this delight. This is what we have faith in this. So we do have a practice here, don't we? Just in the nick of time here. So you are not lost. You are not forsaken. Those who have gone, who have already seen this and are now so delighted, they have not forsaken us. Okay? they do realize our situation. They have been giving advice. They have been helping us out. And they have given us a practice, which is all super important going forward, because there is an element of us that is going to be overwhelmed going forward, and that is the intellect. The intellect is going to be overwhelmed as we go forward, as this dream keeps unfolding, the dream of existence, time, space, process, and form, as this keeps unfolding in this faith-based belief system of what we call world, persons, bodies, time, space, process, and form, nature, dynamics, all of this dream keeps unfolding and churning. It's designed right at this juncture to overwhelm us, to overwhelm the intellect, to overwhelm our ability to sort it out, or it's designed to overwhelm us. Okay. As this faith-based belief system continues, okay, in its belief that God is deceived, and we can deceive God, and this is working, and is okay, it's designed to overwhelm us. Right now at this juncture, okay, this is called we've gotten various alerts about this time. It says you better be prepared. When you reach this time, it's called the end times, the tribulation times, the apocalyptic times, the end of cycle, you know. There are all sorts of different terms. It's designed to overwhelm us. It's designed to overwhelm our reason, our desire to be free. It's like will trying to overwhelm will. You know, using faith to try to overwhelm spiritual will and submerge it. We know about this. Those who don't want to be overwhelmed have been clued into this, have been told by those who already are so delighted that they're already not a body. They already know they're not a body. They already know they're free. They already know they're spirit exactly as God created them to be. And they're so delighted. They're overflowing with delight about this, okay? These are the ones that we label as this and this and this, you know, the great master, the great saint, the great sage, the great avatar, the great guru, the great this. They're simply just so delighted. They're overflowing with delight because they know. They actually know at this juncture. But we can say they see, because they see perfectly they're not a body. They see perfectly they are free. They see perfectly that that they are still spirit, exactly as God created them to be, and so they're overflowing with delight, and so they know what's going on in our attempt to overwhelm ourselves with deceit, self-deceit, and so they know that we're reaching this point, and so they know we need a practice. We need a practice. So when things get all overwhelming, I say, wait a minute, I have this practice where I'm actually in control of the overwhelming, because I have this three-step assertion. I have this conscious wow. I say, I know I'm intentionally overwhelming myself in a positive way. And then I also know, then I work on flipping the script once that cools down. And that leads me right back home to the assertion, an even more effective and powerful assertion, which then overwhelms me with delight, with faith-based belief, faith-based delight. I'm so delighted. I'm overwhelmed with success. So we're consciously overwhelming ourselves with success in getting free of being overwhelmed with self-deceit. All right? This is the genius. This is the effectiveness of this practice that we have those who have already succeeded to thank for. And I am simply a conduit where I've prayed and prayed and prayed and prayed. I said, I know, see, being able to see the future, I used to be able to see it very clearly. I know what's coming. So I said, yeah, we definitely need help. So I'm willing to pray and ask for help. I said, please help us, please help us, please help us, please help us. I will put it into some format here for the world. I'll do that. Please help us, please inspire us, please inspire us. Because I didn't really know what to do about it. It's overwhelming. What do you do? So we are not paralyzed. We are not deer in headlights. Okay? Absolutely not. We have a practice. We are not stunned. We are not overwhelmed. We're not deer in headlights. We're not defeated. Okay? We're not crushed. Not at all. We have a practice. And that is to say, I am so delighted to see. I am so delighted to see that I am not a body, that I'm free, that I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. I am so delighted to see that I am not a body, that I am free, that I am still spirit exactly as God created me. And now I am so delighted to see that I am not a body, that I'm free, that I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. I am so delighted to see that I'm not a body, that I am free, that I am still spirit exactly as God created me. I am so delighted to see that I am not a body, that I am free, that I am still spirit exactly as God created me. And then we say, okay, where are we now? In the wow. All right, so full stop in the wow. We're not bringing the intellect in, right? We understand. We don't. That the whole situation in the world is going to overwhelm the intellect. So that's fine. We don't need it. We don't bring it into the picture. We just practice no spin. Full stop in the wow. We're not neglecting the intellect. We talk a little bit. Okay, it's fine. But it's not being brought into this practice so much, all right? It's full stop in the wow. Because we have intentionally, consciously and intentionally overwhelmed ourselves with success temporarily. But we have faith. We have using faith faith and belief in the right way. We know we will get used to this. We can get used to this. And so we'll get familiar with it. As we get familiar with it, automatically then we say, okay, and now I can work on flipping the script if necessary. I mean, to go back to the practice. And the script will say, oh yeah, we can get stuck to the point where we sort of feel like we need to flip the script a little bit. All right? So we check the third phase of this practice, flipping the script. Okay. Once the wow has settled down, we then check to see, okay, what do I need? How do I need to look at this to go back to the assertion, the practicing, the assertion part of our practice? And if that part is still not so bright, you know, that we can't go back to our practice in a bright way, then we wait a little longer for the wow to calm down. That's all. But with faith and confidence, faith that it will, it will. So we have a practice. We will not be submerged. Okay. We're packaging up the submergence and disposing that submergence and disposing of it. We're not going to get caught by using faith in the wrong way, faith-based belief system. We're not going to get caught up in that maelstrom, terrible maelstrom of using it in the wrong way. We're going to use our faith in the right way. We're going to use faith-based belief system in the right way here. And we have a practice to do so. Because if we don't have this practice, we will see how faith-based belief is bringing the world into such a terrible situation. We're being so overwhelmed by it that we'll want to say, oh my gosh, what do I do? And then we'll think, I just got to jettison faith and belief all together instantly, totally. And then that will overwhelm you with continuity fear. And you won't be able to do it, most likely. Won't be able to do it. Theoretically, you can, of course. You're complete sovereign. Theoretically, and abstractly, in abstract theory, of course, it is it's always open. There's nothing stopping you except continuity fear, which is a pragmatic block. It's not an actual, God doesn't put that block there. You know, there's no God block from reality. He's not blocking it. But we're blocking ourselves with continuity fear. And so pragmatically, don't ever put your eggs in that basket. Make sure you're putting some of your eggs in the basket of practice is a better way to put it. So now we're flipping the script. Okay, we're working on flipping the script here. Make sure you put some of your eggs in the basket of practicing. Don't put all your eggs in the basket of I'm going to be able to do it all at once. Just get rid of all faith belief, because then literally time, space, process, and form will absolutely vanish for you without a trace, as if it never were. And you have not the slightest inclination or clue of how to ever get back to it, because it's vanished as if it never was. You'd be basically what we call perfectly enlightened instantly and irreversibly. Now, sure, theoretically you could do this, but don't place all your eggs in that basket, because we have the advice from those who have already overflowing with delight, knowing they're not a body, they're free, they're still spirit, exactly as God created them to be, who are already completely overflowing with it. They tell us that this is extremely unlikely and rare that anyone will do this. Do not put all your eggs in that basket, they say. Super important advice. Do not put all your eggs in that basket. Use your spiritual will to put some eggs in the basket of spiritual practicing, of this practice here. Since we're talking to those who are practicing this or are willing to practice this, we don't need to address those who are doing some other practice, etc. They're going to do, theoretically, of course, there are different ways to format. They can format it the way that the advice that they got. We're following the advice that we've gotten here. So don't put all your eggs in the basket of thinking that you can instantly jettison all faith, belief, time, space, process, form, all delusion, all dream, irreversible enlightenment instantly. Don't put all faith in that basket without any practicing at all, okay? Don't put the faith, because the continuity fear is going to get you. And those who are enlightened and overflowing with delight, they've already practiced in some other lifetime or this lifetime, etc. And so it may seem like they just, oh, I can just jettison it all, no problem, like Ramana Maharshi did. But that's because of great practice and success previously in our lifetime, and likely in that instance, they had already been perfectly enlightened in another lifetime, so to speak, and they came back out of compassion to help us in this world. And so they just went through kind of a normal childhood and then just say, okay, now it's time, jettison it like that. It's because they were already enlightened. That's like an avatar, okay, or bodhisattva, okay. Those who are already overflowing with delight that they're not a body, that they're overflowing with delight that they see they're not a body, that they're free, that they're exactly as God, still spirit, exactly as God created them to be. They already have completely accepted this. They can reappear in this dream and help us out. They call them avatars, saviors, bodhisattvas, various terminologies like this. And so when they reappear as a body here, at some point they're going to, you know, be enlightened again. They'll be fully functioning as a fully enlightened being here. And it may happen very quickly and easily for them, right? Because they've already been enlightened. They're coming back just out of compassion for us. We are not in those shoes. Okay, so if someone happens to be in those shoes, great. Thank you for coming back here and helping us. But under no circumstances is what happened to them should be our model to expect. In no way. And those who did that have made that very clear to us. And Ramana Maharshi made it very clear. No one succeeds without a great effort to do so, he says. And Sri Sri Anandamayi, he said, leave me out of this. meaning do not use my example as the model for what you're supposed to do. Leave my, I've never had karma. I've never had a faith-based belief system at all. This is completely an appearance of 100% compassion, nothing else. Nothing else is involved whatsoever. So leave this model out of the picture as far as what you're supposed to do entirely. So we have to listen to them, don't we? Because if we don't, we're being foolish. We're using faith in the wrong way. So this little talk here is flipping the script. Okay, we're flipping the script, realizing, wow, we do need to practice, absolutely. That's the advice of those who are here out of pure compassion, is we do need to practice. So we follow that advice. We need to practice because of, not because we're inferior to them, but because of our continuity fear, having used a faith-based belief system to such an extreme extent. We're afraid to abandon faith instantly. We're afraid. It's too much. It's too big of a leap for us. So we just say, okay. We practice. We say, I'm so delighted. We use our faith to practice. I'm so delighted to see that I'm not a body, that I'm free, that I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. I am so delighted to see that I am free, not that I'm not a body, that I am free, that I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. I am so delighted to see that I am not a body, that I am free, that I am spirit exactly as God created me. I am just overflowing with delight to see that I'm not a body, that I'm free, that I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. Now, what we're doing here is we have a practice, right? Three phases. And so we go into the wow phase now. And so I'm doing this, we're doing this, walking together in the wow, because we are beginners at this, so to speak. But the good news is this practice is extremely effective. This is my intuition about it, and this is what I've glimpsed. So this is the one, when I say come to this in a severely modest attitude of meek, humble, unassuming, meek, humble, and unassuming, because part of it is that we're beginners at this, okay? But the other part is this is an extremely effective practice. That's the good news. So we do have to accept that we're beginners at this. This is the humbleness, okay? And if others want to make claims for themselves, etc., that is fine. It doesn't concern us. We're beginners. We're beginners. And yet what we're beginning on is an extraordinarily effective practice, spiritual practice, designed to be so. By some really, really great designers. Those who really are so overflowing with delight, and they're so accepting of this, that they're not a body, that they're free, that they're still spirit exactly as God created them to be, that they know you too can overflow with delight like this, and this is designed to enable us to do so. Right use of faith, right use of faith-based belief. Okay, so we do take these stops. There's some wow, and now I'm flipping the script. We're in the flip script. Okay, there's a little wow. I didn't build up too much of it. So we practice for a little bit. Then we full stop in the wow. And then we flip the script, kind of talk a little bit to get back into the... Then we practice again. It's like kind of like wind sprints. You do a wind sprint. You cool down from the wind sprint. Then you motivate yourself to do another wind sprint. You talk about cardio. You want to get your cardio in shape, so to speak, spiritual cardio. That's the way to do it. You know, we're wind sprinting up a hill. I mean, we're sprinting up hills. Get to the top of the hill. It's like, wow, okay. Now we kind of walk down the hill or jog down the hill. And then we get on the flat for a little while. We recover our will to do it again, and then we do it again. very, very effective practice. So we say, yes, I already know, I already have a practice. Yes, I already know that I already have a practice. Yes, I already know that I already have a practice. Yes, I already know that I already have a very successful practice. Yes, I already know that I already have a very successful practice. Right use of faith here. Yes, I already know that I already have a very successful practice. Yes, I already know that I already have a very successful practice, full stop in the wow, because I can feel it's already building up this feeling like, wow, I'm so blessed, this is fantastic, this is one, excuse me, yes, it's like, wow, this is just, wow, this is great. Again, we don't slouch and we don't get goofy, that's the other part. Spiritual Marines here, okay, we're spiritual Marines, humble. See, a spiritual Marine knows that their mission is very intense, okay? They know they're going to succeed. There's no doubt in their mind, but they know it's going to be intense, okay? So they're humble. They're not bragging and stuff. No, that's fear. You know, they don't let themselves brag. They're humble. They realize, hey, this is going to be very intense. We know that. So, and we haven't done anything yet, you know, so we're just, you know, so stay humble. Don't slouch. Don't get goofy. This is pretty much, and hands to hands, don't slouch. Don't get goofy. Severely modest. We come to this practice with severe modesty. And that's just an overall holistic severe modesty. Body, speech, demeanor, everything. So we come to this with severe modesty, very sober. We're just beginners, right? Nothing to brag about. However, this is, we're beginners with an extremely successful practice program, an extremely successful practice program that will no doubt work for us. So, yes, I already know. I already have an extremely successful practice program. Practice. Yes, I already know that I already have an extremely successful practice. Yes, I already know that I already have an extremely successful practice. Stop in the wow. Full stop in the wow. Be conscious of it. This is in also to do this practice, it must be insisted on that we don't use stimulants. That we don't try to hype ourselves up, because then we'll miss the clues. You have to feel the wow. You have to be aware of the intensity that the practice is producing. So if you use artificial stimulants, you're short-circuiting the whole situation, because this practice brings up its own intensity, and we have to catch that and realize, wow, here's the wave, surf this wave. And if there's some wave of artificial intensity and we try to surf that, then we're going to go get wrecked on the rocks, okay? That wave takes us in towards the rocks instead of into the beach. We don't want to surf that wave. So this practice brings up all the intensity you can handle and more. You don't need any stimulants to artificially boost the intensity. See, the problem is when the intellect is, it doesn't know how to practice properly, is overwhelmed by spiritual will and faith, that it tries to get intensity through stimulus, sex, drugs, rock and roll. Okay, those three, sex, drugs, rock and roll, are basically the stimulants that we have to avoid. Okay, rock and roll really means music, but especially rock and roll music, but music in general, sex, drugs, rock and roll, you must put those aside on the sidelines in order to do this practice properly. And of course, you know, well, This is kind of a wow thing already, isn't it? It's like, wow, yeah. Put sex, drugs, rock and roll on the sidelines, along with the intellect. They're not needed here. This produces its own intensity. And the intensity here is like nothing you've experienced before, really. And there's no way you can keep going with this practicing unless you are become sensitive and aware of how you're feeling based on the practicing. How is this practicing working for you? And be conscious of it. And be conscious of the wow. So you don't overdo it. You can push yourself up the hill, right? But, you know, it is possible for us, right, to overdo it. You can overdo exercise to the point where you start getting injured and you break down. So we push ourselves to the maximum without overdoing it, without overdoing it. And all of us are conscious that we, any time we can stop, we can shift to the second phase of wow, full stop in the wow. Whenever you feel it, it's fine. You don't have to keep on practicing. For instance, if I'm giving the assertion out, you don't have to focus on that. If you're in the wow, you don't have to focus on that at all. Just stay in the wow. And at some point, you'll be ready to flip the script. And then at some point, you'll hear me talk about flipping the script. And then you'll feel bright again, some brightness about asserting. And then you'll assert again. And then you'll build up the wow. And then you'll stop for a while. And it just goes like that. But you have to be aware of this, the dynamics of it. You have to be able to feel it and aware of it without any art, without anything else interfering, no sex, no drugs, no rock and roll interfering with it at all, because those definitely will mislead you. This is the intellect. When it's the intellect who uses sex, drugs, and rock and roll to try to get some intensity, artificial intensity, thinking that it can succeed that way. Somehow that means it's succeeding, which is crazy logic, right? Just because you have intensity doesn't mean necessarily you're succeeding if you're artificially bringing that into the picture. So with this practice, this has all the intensity anybody can handle. And the more we assert with clarity, the greater the intensity becomes. The more it overflows. The delight, you know, the more we start feeling the delight. And the delight we actually start feeling. And we actually start realizing this is working. You know, this is working. I am overflowing with delight. This is happening. We're using our, and you know, you start to realize this really does work. And what better intensity can there possibly be than that? There's nothing, no intensity that can come close to this in terms of what we really want. So the intellect will try to overcompensate with sex, drugs, and rock and roll to get some intensity that's even more intense. But that's quantity instead of quality. We're talking about the quality of intensity here, which is this dawning realization that this practice is working, and we have already succeeded ultimately. We know we've already succeeded. Once we get into this practice, we know we've already succeeded. Done deal. You know, it's already succeeded. It's just that we're working, evaporating our continuity fear to the point where we can fully accept this. What better intensity could there possibly be than this? There isn't any. Nothing comes close. So don't even bother trying to reverse engineer and simulate, you know, through sex, drugs, rock and roll, which is what the world is all engaged in right now, trying to reverse engineer delight and trying to get an artificial fake intensity, to stimulate fake intensity, and then build a fake teachings around this fake intensity. This is what the world's engaged with right now. You do not want to get caught up in that, do you? Okay, so what phase of are we in our practice now? We're in the third phase of what? Flipping the script, right? We're talking, so we're flipping the script. And we're saying, whoa, we do not want to get caught up in that fake, artificial situation, right? We do not want to keep having faith in that. So how do we use faith? Oh, in practicing of as if we have succeeded, as if we're succeeding, as if we have already succeeded. So I'm so delighted to see that I'm not a body, that I am free, that I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. I am overflowing with delight to see that I'm not a body, that I am free, that I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. I am so delighted to see that I'm not a body, that I'm free, that I'm still spirit, exactly as God created me. Okay. Now, the wow is here. Why? Because the assertions were clearer, more faith was put into them, brought greater intensity. Now you will, okay, this is a will thing. It's not, well, I won't drag that into it right now. We're in the wow right now. So I was bringing a flipping the script into the wow, which is not right. Let the wow have its time. Just don't slouch. I was starting to slouch there. Slouch means kind of cave in your cavity like this, and you know, kind of like, now keep the spine straight, and don't cave in the cavity here. Don't cave it in. Kind of shoulders back a little bit, head up. We're not doing yoga here. No, we're not. We're just not slouching. That's all. Okay? Because the sex, drugs, and rock and roll can bring yoga into the whole situation of posture. Oh, I have such a good posture. As if, you know, that then I can handle the artificial intensity better by this. There's a lot of that going on in the world. We're not doing yoga here. Okay? We're just simply not slouching. That's all. Spiritual Marines, not slouching. Very humble, intense mission here. And so here we just breathe, and we feel the intensity, the shock that this is working, that we're succeeding, that this is what liberates us. At least for us, this is what liberates us. We will succeed. It's guaranteed. It's already happened. I've already succeeded at this practice. It's just we are reenacting it, so to speak. What's that? I don't know what that was. Huh. Oh, doors being slammed and such. I got no way to pause this. That is the only trouble. That would be great feature to have, isn't it? But no pausing. Well, of course, there's no pausing in this world, is there? We can't hit really a pause button in the world, can we? No. Faith is always active. Our spiritual will is always active. Belief is always active. Our thinking is always active. So if I'm talking, we're in flip the script mode. If we're quiet, we're in a full stop in the wow mode. If we're asserting, we're in assertion mode. So we're knowing our practice now is what we're doing. We're coming to know our practice here. Which is, you know, it's a step. See, this is a step we take. We don't want to force things at this point. We're just coming to know our practice. Hey, we do have a practice. Wow. That in itself is a huge wow, which means we're going to succeed. In fact, we've already succeeded. And sometimes in flipping the script mode, we go back into the wow mode too. We go back to it because yeah, what we say is like, wow. And so we're not quite ready to practice assert again, to assert again. But you'll feel it when you're ready to assert again. You'll just feel like, oh, okay, I've got some will to do this. And so you can practice this on your own, okay? As you gain sensitivity to the practice, you'll be able to do it on your own. And you'll begin to recognize, okay, I have the will to practice assert, so now I'm asserting. And by doing this, you're building up this wow, like a success. And then, wow, I'm succeeding. Get used to that fact that you're succeeding. In fact, you get used to the fact that you're accepting you've already succeeded. That is the success in accepting you've already succeeded. And then after that, you get used to it. You kind of have a little talk with yourself. You put it in perspective. Flip the script. Anything that's bugging you, you work to flip the script to get more momentum and brightness to practice. And then you assert, brightness to assert. And then you assert again. You say, okay. And you just go like that. 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. And maintain your discipline. Okay, this is for discipline. Those who have the will to be disciplined. Spiritual will can be used and will. Can use faith and belief, faith-based belief system driven to discipline, to have discipline. Discipline. You put stuff on the sidelines. The sex, drugs, rock and roll, put on the sidelines. The intellect, on the sidelines. The dialogue, on the sidelines. The arguing, on the sidelines. The artificial intensities of arguing and dialogue and all that, on the sidelines. We don't need that intensity, artificial intensity. We have the real intensity here. And yes, we're just beginners, so overall, severe modesty. Overall, severe modesty, humble. Humility, humble. You're humble. Just a beginner here. We're just beginners here. Just beginners. And yet we're beginners at a supremely effective practice. That's the flip side, right? That's flipping the script. Yes, we're beginners, but we're beginners at a supreme, extremely successful practice. So we practice by saying, I'm so delighted to see. I am so delighted to see that I'm not a body, that I'm free, that I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. I am so delighted to see that I am not a body, that I am free, that I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. I am so delighted to see that I am not a body, that I am free, that I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. Now this is so powerful when done with this faith that it does produce a way. I start getting foggy. By the third one, I start fogging up a little bit. You can feel this fogging upness. You're starting to get a little like jittery. It sort of fogs up the clarity and the brightness of the practice. The brightness of the seeing, the brightness of the faith. If people say, well, do you have a guru, a good teacher? I don't know, but I do. Well, I do have a practice. I'm so delighted. I'm very delighted to have a practice. That's what I have. Who's your teacher? Who's your guru? What do you, you know, who? Well, what I'm delighted to have a practice. That's what I have. I'm very delighted to have this practice. That's all. Very delighted to have this practice. Now, what's your religion? What's your no? I'm for me, I have a practice. I'm very delighted to have the practice, and this is, I'm delighted that this is sufficient for me. I feel sufficient for me. I'm very delighted to have this practice. That's all. And what's this practice? Well, phase four practice, but walking together in the wow is my one way of saying it. Practice is just walking together in the wow, this three-phase practice. Walking together in the wow. So we can jettison wowism and say, we're just referring to the practice. Okay, we just say, walking together in the wow is this practice. We can call it this, walking together in the wow. So, let us practice. I'm so delighted to see. I am so delighted to see that I am not a body, that I am free, that I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. I am so delighted to see that I am not a body, that I am free, that I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. I am so delighted to see that I am not a body, that I am free, that I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. I am so delighted to see that I'm not a body, that I am free, that I am spirit, still spirit, exactly as God created me. I am so delighted to see that I'm not a body, that I'm free, that I'm still spirit, exactly as God created me. I'm so delighted to see that I am not a body, that I'm free, that I'm still spirit, exactly as God created me. I am so delighted to see that I am not a body, that I am free, that I am still spirit exactly as God created me. Full stop in the wow. Full stop in the wow. Right use of faith, right use of spiritual will. Wind sprints, spiritual wind sprints, and walking together in the wow. Yes, we do have this practice. I'm delighted, so delighted to have this practice. That's it. Why are you on the spiritual path? All I know is I'm so delighted to have this spiritual practice. That's all. That's all I can say. That's all I'm feeling. I'm just very delighted to have the spiritual practice. Yes, I already know that I already have this wonderfully successful spiritual practice. Yes, I already know. And I'm already so delighted to already have this spiritual practice. Yes, I already know that I'm already so delighted to already have this successful spiritual practice. Full stop in the wow. We're being quiet here. Full stop in the wow. So we're not, when we're in full stop in the wow, we're not praying, we're not asserting, we're not thinking, we're not spinning. We're just kind of hanging out, loosely hanging, relaxed, just hanging out. Just, how do you say? No spin. We're in the no spin zone. We're in the no-spin zone here, that's all. Not thinking ahead, not thinking behind, not thinking right now. We're not really thinking. We're not planning. We're not strategizing. We're not emotionalizing. We're not dramatizing. We're not scheming. We're just kind of taking a brief pause here. Just a brief pause. And no spin. Brief pause. We're still in our practice. We're in the practice zone. We're in the pause room of the practice zone. No spin zone in the practice room. In the theater of practice, we're in the no spin room now, the no spin zone, the pause room. We just went off stage, take a little pause. Regain our nerve and intensity. Yeah, it takes a lot of nerve to be on the stage of successful practice, the stage of delight. The stage of delight in seeing. The stage of delight in seeing. Stage of delight in seeing. That I am not a body. That I am free. That I am still spirit. Exactly as God created me. The stage of delight of seeing. I am so delighted to see. That I'm not a body. That I'm free. That I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. I am so delighted to see that I'm not a body, that I'm free, that I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. So delighted to have this practice. So again, we're in the wow. Now the wow does transition into the flipping the script phase, okay? So there's a transitioning into that. So I talk a little bit, but it's a gentle, gradual transition. Now sometimes the wow is so strong, we need to just stay with it. We don't need to be concerned with what this is like. Someone will say, oh, this sounds like this practice, or sounds like this practice, or sounds like this. So all I know is I'm delighted that I have this practice. Full stop in the wow. The ego is very clever. But we're delighted. We're using faith in a new way. So I'm delighted that we have this new way to use faith, and we have this practice, and I have this practice. I'm delighted, very delighted, and that's all to say, because it's just like wow for me. The delight it was when I remind myself how fortunate I am. So I'm so delighted that it is a wow. I can't really say anything more really. stop and wow. I'm just giving chance here to full stop. Wow. I'm working on flipping the script a little bit in my mind. What to say next, you know, a little bit. So what are the essential aspects of this practice? Well, the root convention, the root assertion, which is our one convention we have, of always being able to return to that, that's super important. This is one of the essentials. The will to practice and use the as the faith in the right way, as if we've already succeeded, we have the faith that this is already for sure success. This is an essential. The full stop and the wow. This is an essential. No spin. The flipping the script is an essential to look at in a different way. And severe modesty. The overall severe modesty of no stimulants, okay? The willingness to accept an overall severe modesty is super important too. That's an essential. Sound. I'll practice this right now. Let's do that right now. Okay, we're back. All right, we didn't get interrupted. So I do have a way to sort of pause it. Okay, so if you understand, go to, if there's an interruption, I'll just pause. And then come back. So when there's an interruption, just stay in full stop in the wow, or whatever mode you're in, whatever the three modes you're in, whether it be assertion, full stop in the wow, or flipping the script, just continue with that. Just continue with that. Let me bump this up a little bit. Just continue with that. Great. So if there's an interruption in your life, as we know that this culture impinges upon us to an extraordinary extent and tries to distract us and disrupt us and interfere with our practice, for sure. Because it's setting up an artificial stimulation, intensity, artificial teaching, artificial results, wrong use of faith, bad use of faith, bad use of belief, bad in whimsical use of spiritual will and desire, whimsical use, trying to deceive God, trying to make ourselves greater than God by making God lesser, whimsicality. So that, of course, will interrupt us at times. And so what we do is we simply determine, well, what phase of the practice am I in to get back to the practice? We realize there's three phases to the practice. The fourth phase ultimately is the success, the overflowing delight. So we say fourth phase practice, meaning we are now practicing what we need in order for this fourth phase-ness, this overflowing delight to seeing to happen and the overflowing delight to happen. Is there a fifth phase? Not really. Because what you would call the fifth phase is beyond what we can do here, which is a knowing. And we're told that it's impossible to have this knowing, practically impossible to have this knowing here in this world. And if it's insisted on just a pure knowing, we will vanish from this all. So we cannot have this knowing, but we can have this seeing. We can have healed perception. This is what's called the fourth phase, healed perception. So fourth phase practice is bringing us to healed perception. Fourth phase practice is bringing us to healed perception. And in this fourth phase practice, we have, this practice has three phases that leads to the fourth. Okay, three phases. So what, as we were practicing this, walking together in the wow, what of the three phases are we in? Are we in the assertion phase? We feel ready to assert. Are we in the wow phase where we need to just get back to no spin? Or are we in the flip the script phase where we need to work to somehow transition back into the assertion phase? And just sort of become aware, well, what phase are you in of that? And again, if you're using artificial stimulus, you won't be able to discern that. You'll get all confused and bungle it. And then you claim it doesn't work. Claim it doesn't work. So if you want to do this practice, you need to set the sex, drugs, and rock and roll to the side. You need to set them down. And you need to bring in severe modesty to your being. Okay? Severe modesty. Overall severe modesty. How you dress, how you present yourself, how you're thinking, your thoughts, your actions, you know, and you don't slouch and you don't goof off, you don't get goofy. Okay, it's a discipline, all right? You stay sober. You stay sober. That's necessary. It's necessary for it to do this practice. It's necessary. Otherwise, you're going to get entirely confused. The wheels are going to come off. And your discipline, you're a spiritual marine, your discipline. And you stop indulging in fantasies of failure. Okay. That's not part of the practice. This practice will succeed. So we're not worried about fantasies of failure. The ego will try to pull you down into, well, what if this, what if this, what, try to pull you in. So we're not indulging in fantasies of failure. No way. Because, yes, I already know that I've already succeeded. Yes, I already know that I've already succeeded. Whatever your situation seems to be, however terrible it seems to be, we use faith in the right way now. So, and we say, yes, I have, we're saying, but yes, I already know that I've already succeeded in what? The fact that I'm not troubled by anything any longer. I don't have any troubles. I'm untroubled entirely. Yes, I already know that I've already succeeded in being entirely untroubled. And that are successful, we will be overflowing with delight. Okay, this is what we'll eventually feel. This is what we'll eventually feel. We will be overflowing with delight. We will be overflowing with delight. This is a fact. And so we are using our faith to assert this. Yes, I already know that I'm already overflowing with delight. Yes, I already know that I'm already overflowing with delight. So we, our speech, our written words, our comments, our demeanor, everything is we're disciplined. We're spiritual marines. We're disciplined. We're using our faith in the right way. You're going to use faith one way or the other. Either faith in failure or faith in success. One of the two. There's no fence there. There's no fence there. And so we decide we're going to use our faith in success. Plain and simple. Cut and dry. So in order for me to continue on with this practicing and helping others, those who are going along with this practice will need to be spiritual marines, will need to be disciplined. And that takes a little discipline. Yeah, absolutely it does. We're not undisciplined. I mean, why should we be undisciplined? Think about that. Why be undisciplined? That's using faith to support failure. Plain and simple. And don't be tricked into, again, don't put all your eggs in the basket of saying, well, I don't need to use faith to be disciplined. I can just get rid of faith altogether. So I can continue to be undisciplined. At some point, I'll just throw. That is, don't put all your eggs in that basket, because we have received stringent advice not to do that. This is a losing tactic. A losing strategy, because it is supremely unlikely that you will jettison faith, belief, time, space, process, form, which is just faith and belief, instantly, all at once. Extremely unlikely. Therefore, you do need to put the eggs, some eggs in the basket of discipline. Do not indulge in the old habits of negativity, of using faith as failure, including saying, well, but I don't know how to succeed. Yes, we do know how to succeed. Yes, I already know that I already know how to succeed. Yes, I already know that I already know how to succeed. This practice is how to succeed. So I have the practice. I already know how to succeed. To say, well, I don't know how, that means you don't have a practice. You don't have a practice yet. So they're suggesting, hey, accept this practice. Make this practice. I already have a practice. I have a practice. I'm delighted to have this practice. This is what it's for. It's not my practice. It's not your practice. It's not anyone's practice, except it's the practice which belongs to those who actually do it. That's all. And I'm simply delighted to have this practice, that's all. I'm simply delighted to have this practice. Now, pragmatically, conventionally, you know, I can say, well, I'm the one who's putting it into form, so to speak, formatting it and clarifying it, etc. But it didn't come from me, it came from those who have already succeeded at this, suggesting that this is a very successful practice. In fact, it's a completely successful practice. So, if accepting this practice, I have a practice, then that brings you in automatically into discipline. The practice is important to you. This is your lifeboat. Okay. Now, if you have a lifeboat and the Titanic is sunk and you're in a lifeboat, are you going to like start poking holes in the lifeboat? No. Right? Do you think the other people in the lifeboat are gonna look at you and say, "Oh, you're poking holes. How great. Wonderful." No, they're going to say, "Knock it off." Discipline here. Severe modesty here. Discipline. Faith that in the success of this practice. Don't, you know, have faith in the success of the lifeboat is will float. Don't start poking holes and say, "Hey, it looks like this lifeboat isn't working so well." Of course, if you're using faith in the negative way, it's not going. That's not the practice. So what you're really will be saying is, "I'm practicing in a different way, and it's not working. Faith isn't working." Well, we're using faith in a different way here. We're flipping the script. We flipped the script here already. Flipped the script. Call it a leap of faith. It's a leap of faith because we're using faith in a different way. It's a flipping of the script of faith, actually. So, of course, those in the lifeboat are saying, "Hey, let's keep the lifeboat neat. Let's keep it clean. Let's not rock the boat. Let's not poke holes in the boat. Let's not try to capsize the boat." Right? Obviously. Let's keep this extremely modest sobriety in the boat, right? We're not going to be carousing. There's no drunken carousal here. There's no wild music here. We're not dancing here. We're sitting quietly in the lifeboat saying, "Wow, this is great." As all around us, everyone is sinking and drowning in this icy ocean. I mean, that's not great. We're not happy about that, but we're very happy we're in this lifeboat. And we're just sitting here calmly, staying calm, practicing, right? The practice is our lifeboat. The practice is our lifeboat during these times. The practice is our lifeboat. So I am so delighted to see that I am not a body. I'm so delighted to see I'm not a body. I'm free. I'm still spirit, exactly as God created me. I'm so delighted to see I am not a body. I am free. I'm still spirit, exactly as God created me. I'm so delighted to see I'm not a body. I'm free. I'm still spirit, exactly as God created me. I'm so delighted to see that I am not a body, that I am free, that I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. I'm so delighted to see that I'm not a body, that I am free. That I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. The practice is our lifeboat. How are we doing here? I can't see anything. How long we've been going? I don't know. Something. My eyes are not so good. Okay, well, we've been doing well. Right on 144. I looked up 44. I wanted to know, what's 44? And it comes up a lot. It means great success in practice. It's this number. It means great skill and great practice. Great skill and success in practicing, in right practice. This is the meaning of 44. Wow. I said, "Oh, no wonder why this number keeps coming up. Has come up before for me a few times in very crucial situations." It means, at first, I was intimidated. I had this dream, and I misinterpreted it. I had a dream, a very potent, powerful dream. And I was being this 44 Magnum gun was being pointed at me. And I felt they wanted to kill me. And I said, no, I'm not going to be killed. I'm not going to be killed this way. And I got out of that situation. But what happened, and then later there was this goddess walking down the road, and I suddenly jumped over to her side and went her direction. And I thought, oh, that saved me. But looking in hindsight, what I now see is that that 44 being pointed at me was the pressure I was feeling from truth to practice, and my unwillingness to practice, and my old lazy habits of trying to do it artificially and fake it. And the goddess is the one who's, of course, so inspiring wrong use of faith in art, sex, drugs, rock and roll, artificial intensity, wrong belief system, fake salvation, fake beliefs, and fake everything. And so I got off track because I wasn't willing to practice successfully. This is what happened. And so I wasted a lot of time. But in so doing, there was a silver lining, because now I'm aware that none of that stuff works. Okay. I'm aware it doesn't work. So you could say, well, there's some silver lining, of course. But it would have been much better if I had practiced. You know, I wouldn't have had to go through such hell. So I thought that I misinterpreted the dream. I thought, hey, I did the right thing, and the one pointing the gun at me was the bad guy, the real bad guy. And it's not true. It was the great ones who knew what works, pressuring me. And my pressuring myself, I wanted to do it, to practice, to do right practice. And I said, no, that's, I don't, there's another way I can do it. I can do it, fake it somehow. So now I come across a dream with someone with 44 on them. And I recognize, oh, this is a great, someone who's overflowing with delight, who's so delighted, you know, that they're not a body, that they're free, that they're still spirit, exactly as God created them to be. And they have 44 associated with them. But there's no fear anymore. Why? Because I'd already started to accept the practice, and I had been working on it in the last year plus intensely, to the point where we have this format where we can say we have a practice now. And I've been able to get it into a format that we can see that, yes, I have a practice now. I can have this practice. I can do this. I wasn't bothered at all. In fact, I was grateful. I said, this is great. So it's a great turnaround. Great turnaround. But not without many misadventures and troubles, to say the least. As I went the goddess's way in, got misled to an extraordinary extent, got abused, got discarded in a trash heap, got, you know, just unbelievably exploited. That's what the goddess will do to you, for sure. Will exploit you to an extraordinary extent. And then blame you for the failure, of course. Wrong use of wills, wrong use of faith, wrong use of everything, right? Just because you don't want to use the discipline to practice, right? Just because you don't want. So it's definitely possible and even likely that people will think, oh, that they're being attacked, that this practice is attacking them, because they're lazy. They want to keep faking it, thinking that that's the way. Then they don't want to use their discipline of will and right use of faith. Also, it's based on some ignorance, okay, not realizing the crucial role that faith plays in this whole scenario. We've been using our faith to believe in all of this as if it's actually real and true, and in fact, it's not. It's all actually being imagined in each instant. There's no continuity to the world whatsoever, actually. And we have this faith that there is. So this whole, the glue that holds this dream together is faith. And we have not realized the severity of the continuity problem we have. And the fact we cannot jettison faith altogether instantly. And therefore we have to practice. We have no choice in the matter. And so gradually I've come to see this, and I've realized that it wasn't just my laziness. It was ignorance that made me lazy, you know. And I wasn't really lazy because I was pursuing the goddess's way super with incredible effort and intensity, but I was lazy in terms of I wouldn't quite do what the true teachers are suggesting that I do, which is this right practice. I said, I don't need to do that. I can do it through, you know, music, sex, drugs, rock and roll, sort of, so to speak, artificial stimulation. At that time, I was drinking coffee. In fact, I had it like what they call this. There's a French coffee maker, which is just a glass carafe. And a container, a stainless steel container with you know, fine mesh, and you put the ground up coffee in that, and then you put, you know, super hot boiling water in that. I guess it's, I don't know if you can make boiling water super hot, but let's just say as hot as you can make water, and you just steep it in that for a long time, like a half an hour. One moment. And needless to say, it gets very powerful. And I was just like drinking that continuously all the time. Big problem. Started out with Diet Pepsi, you know. So basically, started Diet Pepsi. I mean, I lost my discipline, got into caffeine stimulant, and then that led to myriads of trouble, to say the least. Lost touch with the sensitivity and awareness of practicing. Wheels came off. Big time. Wheels came off. All the while thinking that I was being super successful and that this was going to work. And I'm still suffering extremely from those troubles at this point, still. You know, mortgaging my future, you know, just believing in the goddess to such an extent that I was willing to just completely mortgage all future. And it's just, you know, it's debacle. So I know that way is extreme trouble. And I know how it goes. It doesn't go well. And you can get into some drastically bad situations where you feel completely hopeless, where you can be hooked on drugs of all sorts, where you can be lived in, you degenerate into degenerate lifestyle and a decaying lifestyle and a slovenly lifestyle, and everything just decays, and you become boastful and you become arrogant and you become a monster, so to speak. I mean, you look at yourself and say, what's wrong with me? I mean, this something's wrong, really wrong. Yeah, all of that, and more, and worse, and more. It's just, you become deprived and depraved, and then thinking, doubling down, I need more artificial stimulation, I need more artificial intensity, because I can't quite get it yet, you know, and I need to, and I have more intellect, and more thinking, and less sleep, and more trying to devise some false way that doesn't work, and more ways to try to induce people into that, and more ways of this, and it goes on and on and on and on, you see, doubling down. So I'm very delighted to have this practice now, very delighted indeed, and very willing to discipline, be a spiritual marine, and be, you know, severely modest. which includes not looking at people, don't look at bodies, don't think of bodies at all. Don't think of bodies, don't look at bodies. Don't pay attention to bodies, other than just pragmatic functionality that you need to have. Don't bring bodies into your mind at all. Shut them out. Shut it out. Don't let your thoughts go in the direction of bodies at all. The goddess is all about bringing your attention and thinking in the direction of bodies. That's what she's all about. Of course, we made that servant, right? We have imagined this servant of the goddess precisely to do that, to try and, you know, keep our faith in our ability to deceive God. And so this goddess is very adept at doing this, at putting our attention back onto bodies, our sex, drugs, rock and roll, the whole syndrome, putting our attention back. She's very adept at that, extremely. It's so much so that we feel like we're helpless to resist. But that's because we're ignorant. We're ignorant of the continuity fear, and we're ignorant of right practice. We're ignorant of right use of faith. We're ignorant of those. Once we gain knowledge and wisdom about this, then we can say, no, God, you're just wishful thinking. You don't have any real power over me. Oh, you're just a servant, and I don't have to use you. Just because you're a servant doesn't mean I have to use you. You see? I can put you on the sidelines. Let me ask you something. What servant is it that dictates to the sovereign of the house how they're supposed to be used, or even if they have to be used? What kind of servant is that? Is that a servant or is that a dictator? Part of being a servant is when the sovereign of the house says, I don't need your services right at this moment, so take a break, cool out, chill out. If I need you, I'll call you. That's part of being a servant. That's the intrinsic part of being a servant. You don't force your services on the sovereign of the house at all. And therein lies the whole importance of spiritual will, because these servants, we have a house full of servants. Imagine if you had a house full of servants, and they're all forcing their services upon you and insisting that, and they're pouring you coffee and alcohol and giving you drugs and sex and music and, you know, Bacchanalian-ness. I had this dream several nights ago suddenly this dream turned into this sensual Bacchanalian situation that was just so unbelievable sensuality in this dream. And I was just like shocked. I said, what in the world? You know, well, this is what the servants are trying to force upon us. You know, Roman orgy, so to speak. Literally. And this is, by the way, the direction the world is going in, actually. Extreme sensuality. We don't realize it, but these servants are most definitely directing us, insisting that we take their service, that they serve us this way. We say, whoa, wait a minute. Okay? I'm not ignorant anymore, servants. I've been informed truly by our blessed companions that understand, those who are already overflowing with delight, that they're not bodies, that they're free, that they're still spirit, exactly as God created them to be. They've informed me of what's I'm not ignorant anymore. I'm the sovereign. I'm sovereign. I'm employing you, and I don't have to employ you, actually. I can fire all of you, but because of continuity fear, I'm not firing all of you. Okay, I'm not, but I'm laying down a new law here. And that is, you only serve me when I tell you to. When I tell you to sit on the sidelines, you sit on the sidelines. And that's the way it is. That's the way it is. And then you keep practicing this insistence. When these servants come up and try to serve you and try to put body thoughts in your mind, you say, no, I didn't tell you to serve me. You say, you go sit on the sidelines. And then they're going to start to say, well, it's great that you asked me. I'm so happy you'd be so successful. Now I want to serve you this. No, I told you to sit on the sidelines. These servants are very importune and aggressive in insisting that they're trying to force their services upon you. This is why meditation is so important. Meditation is really one way of looking at it. As the discipline in your mind as you go about your day is to insist that these servants sit on the sideline. And they, and even if they say, well, you called me to serve you. I said, well, I'm now changing my mind and I'm telling you to sit on the sidelines. And they say, well, you can't change your mind. That's not fair. I say, who are you to tell me what's fair and not fair in terms of servants? If I tell you, I'll tell you what's fair. And what's fair is I can change my mind. That's what's fair. What servant is it that insists that the sovereign of the house has no right to change their mind? And then the servant's pouring them coffee, and they say, well, you can't stop drinking coffee. You can't change your mind because that's why, because I'm a servant. I'm telling you, you can't change your mind. Whoa, wait a minute here. Who's in charge here? I'm telling you right now that before I asked you to serve me coffee, and now my tastes have changed, and I'm telling you I don't want you to serve me coffee, so you're now not serving me coffee, and you're quietly sitting there on the sidelines waiting to be summoned if necessary. So we have a global problem in this world where the servants are in charge, so to speak, psychically speaking. They're dictating to us spiritually. So you have a spiritual collapse of this planet, so to speak, of the will. Spiritual will on this planet is being collapsed because the servants are telling us we can't change our mind and say, hey, no, I don't want you to serve me that way anymore. This is what's going on in this world. Takeover by the servants, so to speak, in a psychic way I'm talking about, and this manifests in a world where the servant mentality of serving in a way that we don't want is dominating now. It's dominating. Say, no, we you made us to do this for you, therefore we're going to do this for you, and you can't tell us otherwise. It's like a revolt. It's like an insurrection. That is a coup d'etat is taking place in this world. Where what spiritual will we do have is being overwhelmed by the bad servants who we made to pull us down into wickedness, so to speak, to pull our spiritual will down into paralysis. They're insisting we have no right to change our mind and tell them to stop serving us in this way. This is what's going on in the world. In a nutshell. So if you do not discipline yourself and your servants, you are certainly going to be pulled down and you're going to be dictated to by these wicked servants. Remember, you made them to be wicked, and now you're used to that, and they're used to that, and this is all they know. But you have the will to tell them to sit on the sidelines. You absolutely do. Now, they may hate it and curse you. So I don't care what, so what? I'm still in charge. I'm the sovereign. I'm the one who has faith in you. You don't have faith in yourself. I'm the one who has faith. I'm the one who has spiritual will. You're just a figment of my imagination. So you're going to do what I tell you to do. So we have to take a very strict line with these servants we have. All of them. If we summon a servant, they respond. And if we tell them to go to the sidelines, and then they respond that way too. They obey us. It's like the mind, the servants of the mind that we have vested faith and belief in, are in charge. We can't have that, because their whole thing is to destroy our will, so to speak, and to claim that this is real. There's no way we can ever change this. Instead of being a silly whim, that it's reality now, and therefore God has been pulled down into it also. That's their job that we gave them. So of course they're just going to do their job, but only if we say so. only if we say so. We have every right to change the orders. We're the ones who give the orders. And of course, we have a servant in there, the goddess, who says that we gave her orders, that if we tell her that we are changing her orders, that she's under orders to pay no attention to this and not obey it. Okay, that's the goddess's orders. So the goddess is sort of in charge of all the servants. You know, sort of like, you know, like a big house, we have tons of servants. There's usually someone who's in charge of all the servants. And you might say that the goddess is the servant who's in charge of all the other servants. And we gave her, the goddess, the instructions as a servant of us. She's a servant still. That if we to say that we've changed our mind and that we're in charge of the servants, not her, that she's to pay no heed to this order and refuse to obey it. In other words, go rogue on us. So we have faith and imagination in this imaginary figure in our imagination, this goddess, who we say is in charge of all the other servants and tells them what to do. That, you know, we trust her to tell the servants what to do, how to serve us, right? And that if we say, well, wait a minute, this isn't working out, which is what I experienced. What I did was I gave full carte blanche to the goddess to tell all the servants how to serve me properly. And this is like the worst decision ever. And all these wicked servants began leading me down to severe wickedness. Because the goddess was telling them how to serve me. They said, do this, 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 this. And I felt, oh, that the goddess is running a great organization here. And everything seemed to be going like amazingly, miraculously almost. That I realized that there was this, I was being guided for sure. Because all the servants were serving me, right? But they were serving the goddess, actually. The goddess was the one who was telling them how to serve me, which was basically to try to destroy my spiritual will. And so I found myself in a terrible spot. So now I go to the goddess and I say, hey, you know, I don't like this. I'm telling you that you're no longer in charge of the servants. I am. And I'll determine which servants serve me and how they serve me. And she just ignored it. Because we have told the goddess, the one who's in charge, that she's in charge of all the servants, not us. And that if we ever decide that we're going to be in charge of the servants, if we ever try to dismiss her responsibility, her service, or saying tell her to sit on the sidelines, that she's to ignore us and to go rogue at that point. So what you have on this planet is a planet is about ready to go rogue on us, okay? This is what's happening. This is what is happening. I've already worked through this whole situation and I'm telling you that this is what's going on. So I put myself through this, and back I did it intentionally to see what's really happening here, to know it and to live it and to be ahead of time. And this is what is happening in this world. That when we say, hey, wait a minute, goddess, we don't like the way this culture is going, the civilization is going, this incorporation of cosmic corporate culture, we can see so many super bad trends happening in the world, actually spiritual trends, from a spiritual standpoint, from the standpoint of spiritual will, and turning this around and freeing us from this incredibly stupid, whimsical effort to lower God down, which we want to set down. We're realizing all these trends that are happening in the world are really working to paralyze our will and working to prevent this. And we say, hey, this, we don't want this. This is bad news for us, really bad news. And so we go to the goddess, essentially. Well, what we say actually is we start talking to these trends, say, hey, I don't want this trend. Stop it. And what happens is then the goddess contacts us and says, hey, what are you doing? You don't tell my servants how to serve you. That's I tell them that. This is what happens. And then we say, well, what do you mean? They're serving me, you know, not you. She says, no, they're under my guidance. I'm responsible for telling them how to serve you, not you. And I say, hey, well, wait a minute. This isn't working out well for me. I'm the one who's supposed to tell them. She goes, no, you're not. That's my job. And then when you tell her, well, stop it, she just ignores you. And keeps right on, even doubling it, and tells her servants to insist even more you know, more wickedness, more coffee, more stimulus, more troubles. Serve them more and more and more and more and more. Goes rogue on you. Goes rogue on you. Insists that she is the one who's calling the shots, not you, and that you have given up your power. You've surrendered your power to her. This is what the goddess tells you, that you don't have your spiritual will anymore, that you've surrendered it to her. Now she has it. But remember, you told her to say this to you, to lie about this to you. See, it's not true, but she's pretending as if it is true, because that's exactly how you made this goddess servant, to do exactly that. Because you knew that you would weaken, you knew you'd want to quit this stupid, whimsical nonsense. And you said, how am I going to keep myself doing this? It's so stupid. And you said, hey, I have to make this servant who becomes a tyrant and goes rogue on me, and who has somehow has captured my will, and that I'm unable to resist their will. And thus we make this goddess. This is what we've done. And we feel unable to resist the will. That's how I felt, unable to resist it. It seems so sure of herself, so arrogantly full of herself, and certain that she knew the way to salvation, that I was unable to resist it. But we set this whole thing up. We're the ones who have made this goddess and sustain it. It comes from our will. It comes from our faith. We're actually sustaining this entirely. It has no continuity on its own whatsoever. None. And yet we're afraid to realize this and drop it all together, because if we do that, we're afraid we'll drop all the servants altogether. And so we get caught in this continuity bind, don't we? Because we think that all the servants are all only responsive to the goddess, not to us. And they act that way. So we think if we get rid of the goddess, we won't have any servants whatsoever. And all faith vanish, and it's too much of a leap for us. So the goddess has got us in a tight spot for sure. We put ourselves in this bind, very bad bind. And this is a global problem in this world. Now, this is the problem of the world, is the goddess is going rogue on us. And you see it I see it everywhere. It's just so blatantly obvious. And you have no right to say anything about it. Who are you to say anything? You have no spiritual will. That is what you're told. You have no spiritual will. What are you talking about? You're a servant of the goddess now. You're just another one of her servants, is what they tell you. That's what the goddess tells you. When you try to assert your spiritual will and say, hey, enough of this. I don't like the way the servants are serving me. I'm telling them to sit on the sidelines. The goddess says, no. You have no right to say that anymore. You have now become my servant. You're just another servant. I'm in charge. Ring a bell, anybody, for what's going on in the world? It should. It's so blatant right now, I have to laugh. I don't even get angry anymore. I just start laughing. It's so ridiculously obvious what's going on. Don't slouch. Don't goof off. Don't get goofy. Full stop in the wild a little bit here. I've been on a run here because this is great information. It's very helpful for me, seeing, wow, this is literally what's going on. So, what do? We start practicing our spiritual will, is what we do. And the key to this, to flip the script on the goddess, is to right use of faith. Flip the use of faith. Saying, yes, I already know that. I've already succeeded. Act as if I'm so delighted. I'm so delighted to see that I'm not a body, that I am free, that I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. I am so delighted to see that I am not a body, that I am free, that I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. I am so delighted to see that I'm not a body, that I'm free, that I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. Now, when we're practicing in this way, guess what? The goddess is on the sideline, okay? And we have servants serving us according to how we want to be served, which is severe modesty, which is practicing. That's what we want to do. The servant of practice is serving us now, okay? The practice of discipline of sitting. We're that's serving us now. We're sitting quietly. That's serving us now. Right use of faith, that's serving us now. These servants are now serving us. See, they're serving us. They're no longer serving the goddess. The goddess is on the sidelines, along with the intellect too, mostly. And when we, if we want to call them to service, we can. If not, they're on the sidelines. End of story. End of story. Yes, I already know that I've already succeeded. Yes, I already know that I'm already sovereign. Yes, I already know that I'm already in charge. Yes, I already know that I'm already free. Yes, I already know that I've already succeeded. Yes, I already know that I'm already so delighted that I've already succeeded. Yes, I already know that I'm so already so delighted that I already have this already successful practice that has already succeeded. Right use of faith. So we're no longer ignorant of this. See, we're no longer ignorant. Ignorance is not bliss. It's enslavement. So, don't argue with the goddess. She's under orders to disobey you entirely and treat you as if you're her servant. So don't argue about it. See, it's already been settled. It's too late for argument. I already know that I've already succeeded in getting free of the goddess. I already know I've already succeeded in being in a successful practice. I already know I'm already enlightened. I already know I'm already sovereign. I already know I'm already not a body. I already know that I'm already free. I already know that I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. This already happened. It's already too late for the goddess. She's on the sidelines now. No argument about it. No longer has a voice in telling the servants what to do. Unless I tell the goddess to, you see. But I'm practicing not telling the goddess to serve that. I think, no, you're on the sidelines. Don't need you. Don't need you anymore. I've got a practice that really works. I've got a real practice that really works. Thanks to those who are already overflowing with delight, knowing that they're not bodies, knowing that they're free, knowing that they're still spirit exactly as God created them to be. Thanks to their right advice. Thanks to their right compassion. Thanks to their being a friend. Not a servant, a friend. What does a friend do? Gives right advice. Right spiritual friend, right spiritual advice. So, what phase are we in practice? A little bit of the wow phase right now, predominating. Keep the posture of a spiritual marine. See, posture of a spiritual marine is like if we look at marines, they always have this posture. What is this? Confident of success posture. They're confident of success. They're not fearful. They're not frightened. They have faith, positive faith in success, in their success, in their mission, in the success of their mission. They have positive faith in the success of their mission. They're not defeated, so they present themselves as confident. We're not trying to present ourselves as overly confident, so we're not yoginis or whatever. We're not practicing yoga. We're just not slouching is all here. We're looking forward, eyes forward. We're not downcast. We're not off to the side. We're not resigned. We're not just, I don't know. We're eyes forward. We're confident in what we're doing. Very confident. In fact, we already know. I already know that I've already succeeded at this. And I realize because of the continuity fear, I need to work, accept it at the level of healed perception instead of knowing. All right, this is wisdom. I know because of the continuity fear, I have this intermediate experiencing of overflowing delight, perceiving the overflowing delight, healed perception. So I have to practice. All right, I know that. But the practicing is to say I know. Okay, but it's still concepts, words, it's still perception. So I know that I already know that I've succeeded at doing everything I need to do at successful practice. I already know that I've already succeeded at successful practice. I already know that I've succeeded at totally successful practice, and I'm already overflowing with delight. I know I'm already overflowing with delight. Now, full stop on the wow. This is a lot of information this video is bringing up. It's an intense step forward, of course. But being a spiritual marine, we expect the intensity, don't we? Anything less would be a disappointment. Anything less would be a disappointment. But there is a lot of wow factor to this. How long has this been going on? Let me see. It's, okay. We're moving along nicely toward 3 hours. So a 3-hour mission is, really makes you a spiritual marine, doesn't it? Be impressed with it. Absolutely, it's impressive. You know, this is like boot camp. Actually, the last couple of years have been like spiritual boot camp. I said that this is like spiritual boot camp, getting ready. And then once you're a spiritual marine, once you start practicing, you are a spiritual marine. The best and the brightest, right? I mean, absolutely. High standard. And 3 hours proves it, doesn't it? 3 hours of this intensity, that proves you are a spiritual marine. So you're in charge. You can practice, absolutely. Just because the goddess has gone rogue, and has always actually been rogue, doesn't mean we have to get rid of faith altogether to get rid of the goddess, the rogue goddess. We do not. We can give a right use to faith. And this is the whole secret and key to success. Isn't all right there? Without doing this, you're going to feel that somehow to get rid of the rogue goddess, either you're going to go along with her, the rogue goddess, and serve her, or you're going to feel you need to get rid of faith altogether to get rid of the rogue goddess. And that brings up too much continuity fear for you, and you won't be able to do it, most likely. In almost every case, you won't be able to do it. And then you're going to get suicidal. Like you say, well, I don't want to go along with the rogue goddess, and I can't get rid of this this faith. I can't get rid of belief in faith just like that. And you're going to feel like a total failure. So I don't know what to do. I don't have any options at all. You see, this is the danger of the situation in this world right now. It's a big danger. Suicidal danger, and then you go into pharmaceuticals. Of course, the goddess says, don't worry. I got all these pharmaceuticals for you. You'll get to feel bad about it. Oh, what a savior I am. She'll say, I got all these pharmaceuticals for you. That antidepressants and all these various drugs they'll have. You'll feel better with that, and then get pulled into more and more drugs, and eventually you end up serving the goddess the way she tells you supposed to serve the goddess, you see. But we're safe from that. We're free of that. We have a practice now. So I don't need to get rid of faith altogether to get rid of the goddess. I don't need to become suicidal at all, thinking I have no option. The options I have are neither one are good. I have this other option, third option here, which is right practice. And I have a practice. And I'm practicing. I'm a spiritual marine. So I don't go down to defeat, not at all. Absolutely, I get free of the goddess, the rogue goddess. I am so delighted to see that I am free. I am so delighted to see that I am not a body. that I am free, that I am still spirit exactly as God created me. I'm so delighted to see that I'm not a body, that I am free, that I am still spirit exactly as God created me. I am so delighted to see that I'm not a body, that I'm free, that I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. This is your ticket home. Now, wow, will you stay wow for a little bit? Don't want to get, my wow might wear off a little quicker than yours, you know, because I've been working at this so intensely for so long. But still, if I'm feeling tremendous wow, but actually because I'm putting so much faith into it, and clarity and faith, that it brings up a lot of wow for me. So, I don't want to just talk over the wow function part of it, because that's, you have to, I mean, this is shockingly good news, isn't it? Shockingly good news. We finally have a way to get rid of that rogue elephant that we told, that we fashioned to overwhelm us, actually. And thank God we have this way now, that we have the wisdom. And I don't take credit for this wisdom. It comes from these great, great ones who have already in overflowing, absolute overflowing delight, knowing. They know. They're gone beyond healed perception. They know. So they're in this, you know, beyondness, beyond all perception, into pure knowing. So they purely know our situation, what to do about it, and they're the ones that have this advice. I'm just following their advice. I did not originate this advice. I'm following it. I may need to maybe an interruption coming up here is possible. So I'm following this advice. That's great. That we can, there's right use of faith. Intermediate step of healed perception. Right use of faith-based belief. Right use of practice. Right use of spiritual will. Choosing a new idea. Understanding we can do this, we have the will to do this, and then doing it. It is like a great gift we've been given, a great gift, absolutely. So I'm just passing it on, say, hey, this gift is available. Possible interruption here, but just hang out in the wow. Just hanging out in the wow here. Maintaining your, not maintaining posture, but simply not slouching. Simply don't slouch and don't get goofy. No spin zone. In a no spin zone here. That's not easy, of course. I mean, this is like, it's so, you know, but intentionally overwhelming. It's overwhelming with success. We're overflowing with success here. But we're doing it consciously, and we realize that we're not going to take it more than 3 hours here, okay? That's a successful mission. If it's going to go over 3 hours, I would say so, and I can't even do that here with this video, the way things are, that it cuts off at 3 hours. So you already know you're not going to go more than 3 hours, on this mission, on the mission here, on your practice mission. This is a spiritual mission. Absolutely. Your mission, should you choose to accept it. Well, speaking of that, I heard that Leonard Nimoy passed away, who played Dr. Spock on Star Trek, of course. Mr. Spock, sorry. Not Doctor, I think it was Mr. Spock. Or Spock, maybe just Spock. Very disciplined character, right? Very humble, very disciplined character. So our mission that we've accepted is to go where no one has gone before. Well, some have gone before, actually, in this practice. Some have overflowing delight in knowing they're not bodies, that they're free, that they're still spirit exactly as God created them to be. Most certainly some have done that. And we're just very blessed to get right advice and assurance from them to practice this way. So we're overflowing with this intensity of success. This is what this practice does. It actually brings up this intensity of success. You just say, oh my gosh, this really is going to work. This really is working. This really is the ticket home. No doubt. You can feel it intuitively, spiritually. You realize, yes, this is it. And this brings a great wow to the situation, to your overall consideration. All the planning, the scheming, the dreaming of a future, what you need to do and everything. Now you realize, wow, all of that's going, I have a different outlook now. I will be overflowing with delight, actually. And cluing in others into this practice. You know, they say, wow, overflowing with delight, that's great. That will be my now, my nowness, absolutely. So if we're quiet, what are we in phase? We're in the full stop in the wow phase. If we're a little chatty, what phase are we in? Flipping the script phase. If we're asserting, what phase are we in? Obviously, we're in the asserting phase. And all we need to remind ourselves is don't slouch and don't goof off. Those are the two most important. Attitude of severe modesty is also very important, and hands to hands, just keep the hands to hands. Often I just have them sort of like this, just together like this, just hands to hands. By my knees here, just hands to hands, just. And if you're talking, use the hands like this, but just hands to hands. Hands to hands, okay. So I may have some interruption coming up here. It's quite possible. Hopefully not. Hopefully the Holy Spirit can say there's no interruption. We don't need that. So we're just allowing the wow of this to, you know, percolate through our system. The total wow of the whole video here, the whole practice session here. We're allowing that to percolate through, saturate, feel saturated by it. Just what? Familiarity. We're allowing familiarity to set in. Familiarity really ends up being the ultimate trump card of everything. Under duress, we always go to what we're familiar with. So certainly, by becoming familiar with this under the duress that is to come in this world, this rogue world, this world gone rogue, is what's really happening. We default back to practice. And ultimately, we default back to overflowing delight. We're so delighted. I'm so delighted. This overflowing delight is just, it's everywhere. It's just overflowing. It's like rain. It's everywhere. Speaking of that, we had a little bit of rain overnight, and that might be it. We're supposed to have a little bit. We got so little here. California officially entered into the fourth year of drought. Doesn't matter whether it rains or not. At this point, we're in the fourth year of severe drought. That's another huge factor that is going to drive a lot of situations going on forward. We might be able to squeak through this year with rationing and severe cutbacks and all this stuff. But if it does enter a fifth year, this is catastrophe. And there's nothing to say it won't. Truly, this is going to end up being a human catastrophe if it goes in the fifth year. I don't see a human catastrophe in this year. I do see great, great trouble and concern and cutbacks and realization, we're on the brink of a human catastrophe here in California. Yeah, if it goes into a fifth year, you know, severe, then look out. But certainly, I talk to people all the time. I mention that everyone seems to be kind of like just in a daze, not really focused on it. You know, they don't, hopefully it'll rain. They say, hopefully we should get some more rain. You know, that's pretty much it for most people. Some people realize, yeah, this is a potential human catastrophe going on here. But most of them, no, they're not able to deal with that, you see. Probably the goddess is telling them, don't worry, we have drugs for that too. No problem. You get all agitated and concerned, we have drugs for that. Human catastrophe, don't worry, we'll relocate you or something. I don't know, you know, you get reassurances, whatever. But say, don't worry, but no problems, not a problem. Not a problem. Hopefully it will get rain, but, I'd say the odds are somewhat against it at this point. The odds aren't looking good. Odds aren't looking good. And this is part of the world-going rogueness which is coming. World-going rogueness. Most of the world's leaders are servants of the goddess, the rogue goddess, absolutely are. They don't have spiritual will. They simply do what the goddess tells them to do. They've put themselves in that position because they're ignorant. They're spiritually ignorant. They don't realize there's a right use of faith and will and practice. They don't realize that. What about religions? Do you think? Well, religions in the first phase are designed to get right habits of severe modesty. This is what they start out with. You have to have right practices. Eliminate the artificial stimulus. Eliminate attention to the body. Or try to dampen it down. This is super important practice. So you see religions, they start out and they have all these laws and rules, and this is how you're supposed to dress, this is how you're supposed to act and speak, and these things are not permitted, and all these. Well, that's super important, because without that, you can't even do the right practice. You're not even able to do it. Your wheels will come off, for sure. And then later on, as religion matures, and those who are mature in that religion begin to do right, try to do various right spiritual practices with the discipline and sobriety, and they at least begin to try and flip the script. Okay, so there's a lot of efforts to flip the script and use faith in the right way. And then the full maturity of a religion is actually using faith in the right way very clearly and concisely, which is what we're doing right here. Ultimately, this is the goal. But if you don't get to flipping the script of faith, and then you're ignorant about that, and you've just only done discipline, right habits for a while, and then you let those slide maybe, then the rogue goddess will boss you around and tell you you're her servant, and you will feel helpless to do anything about it, and then you'll end up carrying out the orders that the rogue goddess is giving you. Absolutely. The CCC, the Cosmic Corporate Culture, is the rogue goddess. Absolutely it is. This is all designed to keep this delusion, faith in this delusion, going. That's what it's designed for. And it's designed to tell us we don't have any will to do otherwise. That we have no spiritual will to do otherwise. That we have to keep it going. This is what it tells us. This is a lie. This is a lie. It's a lie we told ourselves. And when we say, okay, that's a lie, we've told a lie to ignore what we say and go rogue on us. And so we have this rogueness going on. Spiritual rogue gone rogue. Rogue elephant, absolutely. Telling us that we're supposed to serve the goddess. That we have to serve the idea we don't have any spiritual will to change this scenario. That this is it. That this is it. This is our home. That this dream scenario of defining what we are and defining reality, thus defining God, that this is it, that this is reality. You know, crazy. This is an insane whim is what it is. And that we're told we have no spiritual will or capability to change this whatsoever, that it's unchangeable, that this is it for us, period. And this is the rogue goddess which we have imagined to insist upon this for us and to claim that we can't do anything about it. Paralyze our will, so to speak. Well, we're not ignorant anymore. Here, we know right use of faith. So we know we can change our will, change what we want to experience. We can set down this whim of trying to define what we are, which what we are is absolute freedom, which of course cannot ever be defined. We can set this down, say, oh, that's a ridiculous, silly whim. We don't need it anymore. And we're going to be interested in other experiencing now. We do have the will to do it. And we can do it, and we will do it. And since that is true, it's already done. It's a fait accompli, it's already done. Done deal. Holy Spirit's already actually worked it all out for us. And it's already finished, already completed. It's already completed, the Holy Spirit's already completed salvation for everyone. That's a fact. So we can assert that. We accept this fact of the Holy Spirit, who knows nothing of time, so to speak. In other words, time does not influence the Holy Spirit or derail its efforts in the slightest bit. It sees our success perfectly right now. How are we doing here? 244. We're at 244. There's a 44 again. Last time I looked, it was 144, and now it's 244. Well, great. That means we're doing great practice. Spiritual Marines, don't slouch. Don't get goofy. That's all. Very simple code here. Don't slouch. Don't go goofy. Severe modesty. So this practice has a very simple practice, very simple code. And I'm so delighted to have this practice. I'm already so delighted to already have this practice. I'm already so delighted to already have this practice. And I'm also going to be pretty happy when this practice ends to get something to eat. Absolutely. What time is it? It's like almost 2:30 in the day. I haven't eaten anything, which is, again, mission before eating food. Mission before food. This practice comes before food, before eating. Absolutely, it does. It's way more important. But we'll get around to eating. Just 3 hours. That's all. Then we get to eat. Spiritual Marines, we don't complain. We enjoy. We're delighted to do this. Absolutely. Love it. So I'm so delighted to see that I'm not a body, that I'm free, that I'm still spirit, exactly as God created me. I'm so delighted to see that I'm not a body. I'm free, I'm still spirit, exactly as God created me. I'm so delighted to see I'm not a body. I'm free, I'm still spirit, exactly as God created me. Now we can use the term that if we want to. I'm so delighted to see that I'm not a body. Or we can not use it, either way. I'm so delighted to see I'm not a body. Or I'm so delighted to see that I'm not a body, that I'm free, that I'm still spirit, exactly as God created me. Or I'm so delighted to see that I am not a body, I'm free, I'm still spirit, exactly as God created me. Equal. Sometimes you use the that, sometimes you feel like that, sometimes you don't. Sometimes you want to emphasize, I'm so delighted to see that I'm not a body, that I'm free, that I'm still spirit, exactly as God created me. Sometimes you want to have that emphasis. That's fine. Or sometimes you want to have it flow like, I'm so delighted to see I'm not a body, I'm free, I'm still spirit, exactly as God created me. And let there not be denominational rifts over that. Use them both, okay? We're ecumenical here. You can use that. Sometimes you feel like a that, sometimes you don't. This practice has got that, and this one don't. And let's not get goofy. Let's not get goofy. So, you can be humorous without being goofy. We're not going to go comedic here. You can still have some humor, but there's a line there, you know, where you start getting goofy, you're starting to move too much, and you're breaking up the focus of it. So yeah, we don't do that. Spiritual Marines have a code. They're proud of the code. Absolutely, it's they know it's to their advantage to have this code. What are spiritual Marines? Successful mission. They know they will be successful at their mission. In fact, they've already been successful. So for us, we know we've already been successful at this. We're just reenacting this here at the level of perception. Okay? But we've already succeeded. So why do we think we have the right to do this? Because we've already succeeded. That's why. It's already succeeded. I know I've already succeeded at this. I know I've already succeeded at this. And that's a fact. I know I've already succeeded at this. So, but we do need, because of the continuity fear, to reenact this at the level of perception. So that's all we're doing here. Right? So, it is true. I already know that I'm already overflowing with delight. This is true. In spirit, I already am. We all are. But we're reenacting this at the level of perception, which is still dream. Okay, but it needs to be reenacted because of the continuity fear. So, but we do have the confidence of a spiritual Marine knowing I've already succeeded. So that's why I don't back down from anyone. A spiritual Marine does not back down by anyone. The rogue God is trying to bully them. Say, no, I've already succeeded. So it's impossible to back down. No cause for that whatsoever. What phase are we in now? Maybe we're in the tired phase. Yeah. See, there's humor without getting goofy. I think if I'm sort of feeling I'm in the tired phase right now, as we go towards, it was 2 hours and 50 minutes. We're close to 3 hours, see. So, you know, you start to feel like, okay. But, you know, we don't go goofy. We don't slouch still. But I am starting to feel it. You do get, you know, feel a little tired. I mean, I don't focus on that at all. But what it is it's just at some point you start to feel a little bit of weariness. And I've been outside, and it's cold, and I'm starting to feel the cold. I'm starting, you know, the energy's starting to run down a little bit, and so you start to feel the weariness, and say, okay, that's fine, that's all. So, I am so delighted to see I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. I am so delighted to see that I am not a body, that I am free, that I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. I am so delighted to see that I am not a body, that I am free, that I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. I am so delighted to see that I am not a body, that I am free, that I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. And if it gets a little foggy, that's fine. Don't worry. Fogginess happens when the intellect comes in and tries to grab a hold of it. Say, wait a minute, I have to understand this. No, we already understand it. We've already succeeded. We're just reenacting this. I know I already understand this. I know I already understand. I already know that I already understand all of this. I already know that I already understand all of this. I already know that I already understand all of this. I already know that I already know all of this. This is just a reenactment, okay? This is a reenactment. All thanks, praise to those who are helping us with this. Because this is not ordinarily how we think. This is really flipping the script, isn't it? Right use of faith, really flipping the script. You don't come across this very often here. We've done such a good job of intimidating ourselves, you know, that we don't often come across this. We try to think in this way, and the rogue goddess says, hey, I didn't tell you to think that way. And, oh, yes, God is okay, I'm sorry. Oh, we immediately, you know, like, whoa. I know I've already succeeded. I'm so delighted. I just practiced. I'm so delighted to have this practice. And this commentary is only in the flipping of the script part of the practice. It's only in that context. So I'm not ad hoc commenting to people in general at all. My comments are in the context of flipping the script of this practice. Comments about the rogue goddess, all this stuff's in the context of our practice. And this is helpful to flip the script to help us then feel fresh enough to assert, fresh enough to assert. Fresh enough to assert. I'm so delighted to see I'm not a body. I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. I'm so delighted to see I'm free. I'm so delighted to see I'm not a body. I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. I am so delighted to see I'm not a body. I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. All right. So there's bring a freshness to it, and we'll get better at it. I'm just taking it easy here. I don't want to try to force it here. And this, we're just introducing that, hey, I do have a practice. Isn't that great? And this is a tremendous wow. This is a tremendous wow. And we're probably tremendous wow. Probably getting fairly close to the end of this video. Let me see. Yeah, we are. We are indeed. So we're going to start winding this down now at this point. Okay? We still don't slouch. Okay, but we're wind it down, and making a transition back to our functioning as various kinds of functioning. For me, maybe getting something to eat. Just carry with you that we have a practice. I say, I have a practice and it's in three phases. What phase am I in, kind of in general? And so as you go about the rest of the day, you may want to practice the assertion. Say, I feel like I'm asserting I'm not a body, I am free, I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. I'm not a body, I am free, I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. And you may practice that for a while, then you may stop. And then during the day you might realize, well, what phase am I in now? Maybe I'm in the wow phase. Okay, so let me just kind of practice no spin. Let me not get into any mental spin of anything. Let me just let this wow phase of familiarity. And then some point in the day you might say, oh, I feel like I'm in the flip the script phase, where I feel like I'm sort of considering various options. How do I flip the script, and how do I get even more fresh, clear, bright practicing assertion? You know, how can I even more feel even better? And you may be in that phase where you start thinking, you're brainstorming, kind of brainstorming and feeling inspired of some great insights. And just look at your day as you're in one of these three phases all the time. All the time. One of these three phases all the time. You're in one of these three phases all the time. And then so I'll just say, I'm so delighted I have a practice. And remind yourself, I'm so delighted I have a practice. Right use of faith. Recording limit. Reaching recording limit. Okay, so I'm so nearing recording limit. Please save recording soon. I believe it automatically saves with the title, a generic title. So I'm just going to go all the way to the 3-hour period here. Okay, we're going to be very daring with this, because I've done it before. There's no reason to think it won't do it again. Okay, so I'm so delighted that I have this practice. I'm so delighted that I have this practice. I'm so delighted that I've already succeeded. I already know I've already succeeded. I'm so delighted I have this practice, this reenactment practice, right use of faith. I'm so delighted I have this right use of faith practice, walking together in the wow. And so keep your faith positive. Keep your faith positive that you know, I can use my faith in the right way now. Absolutely. So I'm so delighted I have this practice. So delighted I have this practice. And we're getting closer to the the recording limit. The 3-hour recording limit. We're going to push it all the way through here. Push the mission through all the way 3 hours. And then, okay. So, maintain your severe modesty. Maintain your severe modesty. At all costs, maintain your severe modesty. Thought, word, deed, whatever you say, maintain the positive faith now. Positive faith that sees the success, that knows the success is yours. Knows the truth. Yes, I'm so delighted to see this. That's positive faith. I'm so delighted to see this. Even though if it's blurry, you keep saying, I'm so delighted to see this. Knowing that the blurriness is going to become clearer and clearer and clearer for sure. For sure. For sure. Clearer and clearer and clearer for sure. Clearer and clearer and clearer for sure. I'm so delighted. This is all becoming clearer and clearer and clearer for sure. I'm so delighted. This is all becoming clearer and clearer and clearer for sure. And are we there yet? You know, are we there? 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 So I'm so delighted. This is all becoming clearer and clearer and clearer. And let me look at the recording time. which is, yeah, we're about 9 seconds, 9, 8, 7, counted down. So I'm so delighted. This is becoming clearer and clearer.